our closing remarks, I would like to invite our chief guest, Mr. Suresh Chandra, Secretary of Law, Government of India.
Good evening. The conference director, Dr. Pavan Duggalji, Luis Sous Barbosa-ji, His Excellency Gobind Lubinda, Honorable Minister of Justice, Zambia, Mr. Peter Kempian, Mr. Pradeep Gupta-ji. We have seen the tremendous efforts which have been put by the course director, Dr. Pavan Duggalji. And all these recommendations will slowly will come for our consideration in the government. And we at times feel that technology is moving so fast that we who are making laws or interpreting laws sometimes are lagging behind. And perhaps in a way, I must thank and I must congratulate Dr. Pavan Duggalji, who is sharing the burden of the law ministry also in updating the law and showing us the path, how and we should go and move forward. I shall be failing in my duties if I don't share some of my thoughts relating to the contribution of the information technology. If we see the agricultural revolution brought in the kind of, you know, those who were nomadic culture to the settlements, to the cities, and to more kind of castles and palaces, and later on it felt the need of industrial revolution. And the, after industrial revolution, it is the most important revolution, that is the information technology revolution. In the wake of information revolution comes the network society. It has opened up horizons and tests to the limit of ability of the political and economic leaders to manage the repercussions of the changes. And what changes? Suddenly, those great walls and formidable borders and barriers seem ridiculously meaningless. I want to share one of my gurus, he used to tell, and he has written a book also. I want to share that thought. Sometime back in 1940, he wrote a book. And in that book, he wrote two things, very important ideas. Henceforth, the speed of time will be very fast. And the results of our actions, which used to come earlier, maybe sometimes in the next birth or sometimes after, at the very long period of time, will be very fast. And perhaps I realize now, with this digital world, with the information technology, his words have become true, which he said sometime in 1940. The second very important thought, he said, that the thought pollution is mother of all pollutions. When we talk of cyber crimes, when we talk of cyber terrorism, when we talk of anything, this is something which has evolved, which has the manifestation of the pollution of thoughts. Coming to the data, I would like to share some of the data. released recently by the National Crime Records Bureau of India, that India's rate of conviction for cyber crimes remains abysmally low. Maharashtra was found to have only one conviction in 2015. This problem, however, is not restricted to Maharashtra and can be seen throughout India. The NCRB report shows that in 2015, a total of 8,045 cyber crimes were reported, while 5,102 persons were arrested, only 251 were convicted. This is an increase over the statistics released last year, where 7,201 cyber crimes were reported and only 65 persons were convicted. Despite the increase, it is clear that not much has improved since last year. The number of cases registered with the police has increased by 20% since 2014. Of these, the highest number of cases reported is from Uttar Pradesh, with 2,208 cases, followed by Maharashtra with 2,195 cases, and Karnataka with 1,447 cases. As far as the conviction go, however, UP has the highest number with 99 this year, followed by 29 in Chhattisgarh and 25 in Telangana. So, according to the NCRB data, a total of 11,789 cases are pending investigations. 60% of the cyber crimes cases with policies are pending, while the courts have an even higher pendency rate of 90.3%. The courts are reported to have 6,435 pending trials. Despite the bad news through the NCRB report, some improvement can also be seen. Maharashtra inaugurated well-equipped cyber labs earlier this year. A few months ago, Interpol agreed to assist the Hyderabad police in tracking cyber criminals attacking India from other countries. Increased cooperation for cybercrime resolution has also been promised between India and Israel and India and China. Greater technical expertise and improved international cooperation can go a long way in resolving cyber crimes. Hopefully, these steps will lead to an increased conviction rate by next year. Here, I would like to also share that there is a need of use of information technology, not only for e-governance, for e-commerce, as well as controlling the cyber terrorism or the terrorist funding. And I hope that this conference, which has covered all aspects of the cyber-related laws, cyber space, will definitely give us the instrument and tools to better equip ourselves with the law as well as administrative machinery. I shall be failing in my duties if I don't also discuss certain act and rules which our cyber laws in India governs. These are Information Technology Act 2000 and Information Technology Certifying Authorities Rules 2000, Information Technology Security Procedure Rules 2004, Information Technology Certifying Authority Regulations 2001. Major objective of the Information Technology Act are to provide legal recognition for transactions carried out by means of electronic communication, which is termed as electronic commerce and involves the use of alternatives to paper-based methods of communication and storage of information. To facilitate electronic filing of documents with the government agencies, the aims of the Act make it facilitating Act, an enabling Act, and a regulating Act. The Information Technology Act is also considered as enabling Act, which allows legal system of electronic records and digital signatures. On the other hand, it is also important to look into the issue of online speech and intermediary liabilities in India, wherein the landmark case of Shreya Singhal versus Union of India plays a very important role in the Indian legal system. The case revolves around the fundamental right of freedom of speech and expression under Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution of India, which challenged the constitutional validity of Section 66 of the Act. The Supreme Court, while recognizing the importance of the right to speech, highlighted the liberty of thought and expression, and they said that it is not merely an aspirational ideal, it is also a cardinal value that is of paramount significance under our constitutional scheme. The court further held that Section 66 was not saved by the constitutional scheme. The court further held that Section 66 was not, by virtue of being reasonable restriction on the freedom of speech under Article 19(2), and they have struck it down. While on the same ground, because there were certain reasonable restrictions under Article 19 of the Constitution, they have saved Section 69 of the IT Act. Now, I'm told that Justice Sri Krishna report has come, and the privacy laws are very important, and the Supreme Court has already taken that the right to privacy is a fundamental right under Article 21 of the Constitution. Having said that, this conference again will add into those nuances and will be read along with the high-level committee report. Now, with the increase of the cyber terrorism and with the increase of other crimes related to information technology, the impact of this is very huge. We have nowadays almost all the transactions relating to the banking, financial transactions of the companies. Most of the critical infrastructure that is also nowadays based on information technology, and any malfeasance done will have a very deep and very serious impact. And we have been trying by updating our technology as well as by bringing our laws in tune with the latest developments. Though internet does not have any geographical limits of country, one of the United Nations agencies, that is United Nations Commission on International Trade Law, UNCITRAL, recommended a certain level of consistency of laws in all member nations. For this, the model law on electronics commerce was adopted by the United Nations on international law to control cybercrime around the world. Cyber laws have broad scope in current complex situations and eruption of cyber crime. These laws cover other areas of laws. Having a technology component, laws related to e-commerce, online contracts, copyright, trademark business, software, patenting, e-taxation, e-governance, and cyber crimes fall within the meaning and scope of cyber laws. To summarize, cyber laws offers the vital mechanism to impeach any person who is realistically suspected of having committed or of committing or of being about to carry out any offense using any computer, computer system, or computer network. Cyber law is an important field of law which represents all the legal issues linked with the internet and governs all aspects of the internet. And cyberspace, along with dealing in legal cases regarding software patents, net banking, and others. Cyber legal representatives perform regular investigations on the major cyber crimes that are widespread across the internet. With the growing increase in cyber crimes against individuals, organizations, and government via the internet today, there is a need for strict cyber laws in the global society. Cyber laws which battle cyber crimes have a dominant effect on any other laws for the time being in force. In India, it was observed that there is drastic increase in the number of cyber crimes. Therefore, the field of cyber law in India is gaining huge recognition. Capacity of human mind is unfathomable. It is not possible to eliminate cyber crime from the cyber space. It is quite possible to check them and to attempt to keep the criminalities lowest. The cyber law have to go the extra mile compared to the imposters to keep them at bay. Technology is always a double-edged sword and can be used for both the purposes, good or bad. Hence, it should be the tenacious effort of cyber law to ensure that technology grows in a healthy manner and is used for legal and ethical business growth and not for committing crimes. And finally, I shall be failing in my duties if I don't refer to the outcome documents and the interministerial discussions wherein the shared heritage, cybersecurity, and cyber breaches of the cybersecurity, as well as the regulations which have been envisaged by this conference, have been dealt with in detail. I compare this because nowadays the cyber space is also a physical space. And if you remember that in Indian philosophy, there are five elements. And the fifth element is the Akash. And that is also an element. In those days, they had realized that this is also one of the elements. And now it is becoming true. And one thing, if you remember, and if you, some of the persons may be aware of the philosophical thoughts of Plato, I want to share here. The Plato has given a theory of ideas. And in the theory of ideas, he says that there is a hierarchy of ideas. The lower level ideas and the top level ideas. It is a very long thing, but to cut it short, he says that everything, whatever is there in this world, has an idea. And the idea is perfect, idea is infinite, and it is immortal. So likewise, we have the digital world, and the digital world is also a real world. Now we have realized, and he has visualized, that that idea which he says is a real one, he says whatever in this world, like this table and this, it is imperfect, it is unreal. But that real, that idea which he says that it is a copy of that, that is the real idea. And here, this system of digital world works on the same theory. That is the real world, the real idea which is the digital world, and whatever we achieve may or may not be, because in that there is an human element also. So if you want to achieve the rule of law, if you want to achieve e-governance, then you have to depend upon the information technology. So this is also one of the tool to achieve a rule of law in this. And finally, because of the untiring efforts and constantly developing emerging jurisprudence on cybersecurity, under the leadership of Mr. Dr. Duggal, I think we will achieve all those standards in not only bringing the legislative framework, but also the administrative framework to control all kinds of malfeasance, whether it is cyber crimes, whether it is cyber terrorism or anything. With these words, I stop. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, for your closing remarks. And the speed of time right now indeed seems very fast, because 2 days passed in just the blink of an eye.